Mary Schomburger. I work for NRCS in Winnebago County. And I first met Eric and Sandra, actually Eric in 2018, and then I met Sandra last year during the pandemic. But Eric started out with an EQIP contract with us for some brush management, and then he went to a CSP contract. Following that, he did a pollinator planting through CSP, and then he also planted some trees and shrubs for wildlife.
Probably everyone knows, but does everyone know what CSP and CRP stand for? Okay, so maybe.
And yeah. EQIP. So EQIP stands for the Environmental Quality Incentives Program. It's a cost share program where our agency pays part of conservation practices. The Conservation Stewardship Program, also known as CSP, that looks at your whole farm. You can earn a per acre payment per year on your whole farm based on land use of crop, pasture, or woods. And then the CRP, which Craig mentioned, Conservation Reserve Program, is a grassland program or trees administered through the Farm Service Agency. So that's either a 10 or 15 year program.
So these are all USDA programs, yep, to help farmers financially to do conservation practices of various kinds.
Start. Eric and Sandra are going to take us to the garden first, and then we're going to do a loop in the woods and just kind of go from there. We're going to stop different places, and then you can ask questions along the way.
We're doing the garden for the first time this year. I mean, Eric's parents and Eric have had a garden in the past. It's been here and also up there, so for me personally, it's the first time that I have a garden this size. I really wanted to have a garden because we both want to know what we eat. I love vegetables, and I want to know, you know, I want them natural and not sprayed. And that was also a reason why we raised meat birds and the layers, just so that we're in control of our food. So that's the motivation, basically for our personal use and independence and just for high quality food. So it's 40 by 80, and 40 by 60 is like an annual garden. And the remaining 20 by 40 in the back is a perennial. I researched permaculture. I know there's many principles about it. I took the ones that are basic to me, so to find the companion plants, like which plants like each other, which don't, and then added flowers and herbs for like extra pollination and deterring other like non-beneficial insects. And it's amazing how well it has worked out. So I have pretty much not weeded at all this whole garden. And you'll see, I mean, it looks pretty okay for that. And I haven't watered, so I have to say I watered twice because I got scared. And people have told me, also from Germany, they have told me, oh, you've put so much work in it. If you don't water now and it's gonna go, you know, it's gonna die, then it's gonna be in vain. And then I watered twice, and in the same day it started to pour. So I can say if I hadn't watered, that would have been the same outcome. And that's a very big learning for me, that it's actually possible to grow without watering. I made a plan during our vacation in April. I looked at, so not only companion planting, like which plants like to be next to each other and which don't, but also I wanted to have a crop rotation. This is basically my little farmland, and I have different fields. So this annual section, the 40 by 60, you can see 9 lanes. And so I have, I have heavy feeders, I have light feeders, and then I have something like beans or peas or the cover crops that regenerate the ground. And so it goes 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, and every year I move it over so that I have a crop rotation, and I take into account, you know, what needs how much nutrition and how to replenish the soil. It is amazing to see how many insects are in the garden, like those mini wasps and all these beneficial insects that apparently the flowers do attract. We have the beehive just across, like a little pond. We'll take a look at that in a second. And that has also helped immensely. I think that the garden and the bees, they just work together.
This is not a Langstrom hive, the square ones that you normally see. I'm not here to produce honey. for some commercial purpose. This is simply to bring more pollinators into the world, into our world. And what I did was I took two hollow logs that had fallen down on my range over here. I hollowed them out even more. And this bottom square is called a hive catcher or a swarm catcher. They're kind of fun for me to watch, where they come in and they have their pollen pants, as they call it. They'll come in and bring in pollen, and they're right here next to the pine forest, so they also gather the sap, which is how they build the propolis, which is how they build the wax for the honeycombs and so on. But since we put this in, all the way at the where you first came in, you saw the upper, what used to be the upper garden where we had the chicken, the meat chickens, and then all around the garden, and we've seen them a solid half mile away. They do have about a 5 mile range, so they say. I've never actually asked them how far they go, but we have seen them all over the place, and they are really doing their job as pollinators. So when I put in the butterfly field back there beyond where the raspberries were, that was part of the NRCS program. That's what this is all about too. So they take it and they help those plants thrive, and they help the garden thrive. This was part of our invasive control of the Buckthorn project. We had four male goats. They're about 6 years old, and we had them, as you can see, we had this paddock set up. This half they didn't get to. That half they spent about 10 days on. So you can see the difference of what they did in 10 days, of how it looks. And they're kind of fun. They stay inside because they choose to stay inside. We did have where a deer came in, got caught in the fence, or something got caught in the fence, and then they kind of came up to the house, and then they kind of hang around like, hey, can we play? But once again, when we put this up, we have an energizer. This energizer works pretty good. It runs off a deep cycle marine battery. The interesting thing, you can see the ground rods at about a 10 degree angle. That's because about 8 inches below the soil is the bedrock. So at first I didn't think it was going to work, but it does work if you drive an 8 foot guide rod sideways into the ground. And then we just hooked up and went around this. So we were going to move the goats from here to here. That's why we set up the little shelter the way we did. These are just cattle panels bent over the top with a big tarp over, and it worked really well.
So how aspen works, it's one of the simplest timber types to manage and regenerate. Aspen needs full sunlight to grow, so any kind of shade, it's going to die out. But basically you're doing full clear cut to allow that full sunlight, and then when you sever the stem of aspen trees, it promotes a response called root suckering, and anywhere that the roots are of those trees that have been cut, it will shoot up sprouts. They all will be of the same trees. So these are all aspen trees. These were standing aspen trees this height in February. Then they were cut. This is 1 year's growth. Because we have that 10, 12 inch tree and the root system that goes with that, that is a huge root system that is able to support all of these. If you take the DNA off of these trees, it's the same tree, because it's the same root system. And so what we've done is basically developed clones of the original trees. The buckthorn is here, aspen's here. So as long as the aspen is able to outcompete the buckthorn, you would have to do minimal buckthorn treatment, and you're basically starting the buckthorn off at the same time you're starting the aspen off. The aspen can grow faster, as we can see. The buckthorn will still live underneath, but we'll have a new forest. And that's what it's about.
What we're looking at here is a pine plantation that was planted about 25 years ago, planted in rows, made it the easiest way to plant it. And what we did here is we harvested every third row. This is the initial thinning. So it's the first time we've been in to thin the stand. The intention would be now in about 10 years to come back and travel down that row again and harvest the roughly a third of the stand that's left, thinning from below, taking the poorest quality trees.
this is a great way to kind of take a look at and think about forest management in general. Now this is a pine plantation, so you know, this same kind of principle works for any kind of stand. This thinning was to create access, and this access is for this procedure, this management, and all future management. We took a third. Typical management of any forest stand, if it's not a final harvest, it's an intermediate harvest, meaning we're still looking to grow this stand farther. We want to thin the worst trees, allowing the best trees to get better. So the row thinning doesn't take that in consideration. We're just making access, taking a third. All future harvests, a lot of times it'll be a select mark, so a forester will come through and look at each of the trees. And basically you're trying to identify the worst trees because we want to cut those out. And you're also trying to identify the best trees because those we want to give a little bit more sunlight to make them better. How trees grow, their height will be dependent on their age and the soil quality, nutrients, too much water, too little water, right amount of water. So they'll all be similar height no matter what. Their diameter is relative to how much sunlight they were given. So if we never cut these trees, they would all be very skinny, 4, 5, 6 inch diameter sticks. And even though they're gonna continue to grow in height, they would never get any bigger in diameter. So by coming in every 10 years and taking the forest third out, we are promoting the best trees to grow in diameter faster. And that's really how we manage all forest stands, not just the pine plantation. When you get into mixed forest stands, then you have the option to promote certain species. It really comes down a lot to what the landowner's goals are. You know, what do they want to see on their property? And then, you know, work with your local foresters. We write tree planting plans. We'll come out, look at sites. We'll look up the soil type and then figure out, all right, this is the list of tree species that will grow in your county in this soil type, and then write a tree planting plan accordingly. You know, if you want to plant more for wildlife, you know, you can try some of the hardwoods. Some oaks grow better on sand than others. You know, a lot of things go into those tree planting plans. The biggest part of tree planting as well is the maintenance afterwards. It kind of gets forgotten a lot of times. The hardest part is getting the trees in the ground, but then it's really that 1 to 3 to 5 years after they're in the ground to actually make sure that we control all competition to make sure that the tree survives. We'll be right back.